I was hiking on the Appalachian Trail. I had been on for about a month, and a series of important realizations came to me. The first of which is that although being in the trail really sucked, I was happier than I was beforehand. I went on the Appalachian Trail since I was tired of school and needed a break before I went back into the thick of society. And for all the leeches, mosquitoes, backbreaking exercise, and loneliness, I did prefer it to school. Although it's not useful and/or intelligent for me to put my experience as central to the human race, this sort of burnout and feeling of disconnect from a materially wealthy world is pretty common. The modern world gives us far more of anything physically than any of our ancestors, except perhaps our parents, got. The signs of unhappiness are everywhere. Look at music, art, politics, rent prices, inflation, and the list could go on. I challenge you to find a single form of human expression that's generally happy now. Songs are all about breakups, art is at how terrible the current political regime is, politics basically screams at the other side in discontent, and ideologies are literally based on what amounts to original sin now. This video exists to look at why people are unhappy, what are the causes and the results. So buckle up for a journey across modern civilization and the structures of our lives themselves. One of my intellectual pet peeves is when people complain about modern society without any reference to the rest of the world or history. I find critiques of capitalism, rationality, or in the broadest terms, modern society, that don't look at how people have lived for the vast majority of history ridiculous, given that you need real-world references to understand anything. This brings me to a fascinating documentary I was watching called Tribal Odyssey: Rites of Passage that talks about how tribal peoples live around the world today, and how their tribal cultures deal with the same basic human emotions that we do in very different ways. They look at everyone ranging from the Dinka of South Sudan, the Walani of Papua New Guinea, or the Hmar of Ethiopia. I was able to watch this on Magellan, a documentary streaming service home to the richest and most varied history content anywhere. They have stuff ranging from anthropology, science, music, folklore, history, modern geopolitics, and basically anything else you'd want to learn about. It's compatible with almost all devices and also is 4K without additional cost. Start learning about whatever inspires you on Magellan TV today. There are two things that I think we should give a little more than a passing thought to before I get to the reasons for why I think people are unhappy. The first of which is, although we can't tell exactly whether people were happy across history since there weren't scientific surveys in the 13th century, even if they did have them, I wouldn't trust the results. However, you can use several proxies from cultures to generally figure out how happy people are. Take, for example, the 14th century, which I think was pretty objectively an unhappy century. In the first half, Europe became intensely overpopulated and racked by incredible inequality. People were starving and the papacy was divided in three. Then the Black Death wiped out half of the continent's population. Art and culture in the 14th century went from woe believing this must be the end of the world due to the forces of Satan and corruption winning before the Black Death, to afterwards being horrifically nihilistic and traumatized from watching half of their friends die. The 15th century that came afterwards was much happier. Having Europe's population meant that the people who were left were much wealthier and the society that formed afterwards was healthier, less corrupt, and less unequal. The Italian Renaissance showed a gaiety and love of life, art was extremely bright, and humanism, or belief of the importance of living in this life pleasantly, rather than fear of hellfire, was dominant. Similarly, what got me thinking of this whole topic was when I was on the Appalachian Trail and walking hundreds of miles, I compared my experience to my ancestors in the 19th century. My mother's side is of British extraction and came to America during the colonial era, and then walked from the east coast to the heart of the continent. I thought about how their lives were significantly harder than mine. I walked about 600 miles on the Appalachian Trail and felt dead. The distance people walked in the Oregon Trail was significantly more than that. After that, they had to clear massive forests and set up homesteads with no help. The funny thing is that while America was doing these really tough tasks, that the country was for the most part happy. The mid-19th century was an era of great jubilation in Anglo-America, in which every aspect of the culture gloried in America's greatness. There was immense patriotic pride about the American mission, and you don't see any complaining. If you read presidential candidacies from the 1870s, for example, they argued over stuff as petty as several 10,000 Chinese immigrants and minor diplomatic statements with Britain. This was not a society under immense stress, to say the least. The second main point is that today the whole world seems unhappy. It's shocking to see how common the effects of this disease are. Speaking purely anecdotally from my experience in traveling or talking to friends, The Chinese, for example, seem far unhappier than Westerners, and Europeans and Indians seem at roughly the same degree of unhappiness as Americans. The happiest parts of the world I've dealt with are Latin America, but that could be colored by me hanging out in the nouveau riche parts of the region that just pulled themselves out of poverty. Similarly, this is sort of played out in statistics imperfectly. For example, I would say most North Americans are unhappy with key aspects of their lives and societies. However, they're pretty happy by world standards. Similarly, I would say countries like Denmark and Finland come up very high in happiness, but if you deal with those countries at all or look at their suicide rates, you know that's not the case. It's just that in Scandinavian countries, answering that you're not happy is extremely socially loaded. These are countries where if you have a minimum or decent standard of living, you have to say you're happy to not drag the rest of the community down. Although this is an incredibly imprecise science, scratch that, this isn't science, this is just me making guesses. There are clearly complex, not easy to understand variables at work here. Let's try to figure out what they are. Reason 1. Economic stagnation. This is the easiest to understand answer. In most developed countries, the standard of living has decayed or more commonly declined by most statistics since the 1970s. This is for a series of complex reasons, mostly due to demographics that I have a bunch of videos of talking about. In the US, for example, standard wages have kept still, but the cost of living, especially in stuff like education, housing, healthcare, and the like, has risen exponentially. A perfect example of this coming out of pop culture is Homer Simpson, who in the 1980s was a lower-than-average loser. However, 40 years later, Homer has a lifestyle that's out of reach for most millennial Americans. He's a homeowner, his wife doesn't work, he can take vacations, he has 3 kids and a stable job. Homer was originally meant to be working class, but now his social class really doesn't exist anymore. This isn't just the case in the first world either, to be fair. In places like India, we see massive class bifurcations between a lower class that's seen stagnation due to globalization and an educated class that's seen all the progress. Even among this class, unemployment stalks large parts of the population, which is why my videos in India have so many views. In China, although GDP per capita has risen precipitously, a lot of it gets sucked up in the cost of living. The average urban Chinese lives in a crowded apartment the size of a horse stall and has little social connection. It's very telling that a good Chinese friend of mine once told me that 996 is often a fine standard of living. For those that don't know, 996 means 9 a.m. to 9 p.m. 6 days a week. His cousin works the same but until midnight. In China, they have the lie-down movement, where young Chinese remove themselves from society and work and live at the bare minimum since they just can't take the stress of the society they're born into. I'm not going to go into too much detail about this here, and so nothing I'd say is new, since I've talked about so many of the statistical and demographic causes of this in previous videos. Watch those videos for more details. Number 2, we can't keep up with technological progress. The second answer is that we just went through one of the greatest technological revolutions in history with the information revolution and are still living through the results. I'm Gen Z and seeing this latest batch of kids play with iPads more than Legos still shocks me. The information revolution did a lot of good. It allows my job to exist, for example, and it allowed me to write this episode since I just Uber-eated dinner rather than just having to pick up or cook food. Also, about 4/5 of my friend group now indirectly come from the internet. Our societies haven't been able to deal with the massive social shifts that have come with mass information yet. The biggest factor here is loneliness and lack of human connection. This started actually with the rise of television after World War II, and now the average American spends half of their time watching television and 11% socializing. The problem with this technology is that it hacks into dopamine sectors in our brain to provide short-term pleasure while leaving us in the long-term unfulfilled. It's not a gift that keeps on giving, keeps us leaving depressed, crappy, and lonely. This software is literally designed to be addicting, and so it's turned all of us into addicts who are unable to disassociate. The perfect example of this sort of thing is dating apps, which no one really likes, but because people's social networks have become so much smaller, have become necessary. Dating apps play against human psychology since they don't allow any of the physiological parts of courtship. Girls go after hot guys who then ghost them since they haven't built up an impersonal connection, and guys feel like the system is rigged against them since women are inherently pickier than men and men are winnowed down to a single variable of attractiveness, throwing others like charisma, how well-dressed you are, and game out the window. Both sexes leave dating apps feeling unfulfilled and lonely, missing out on the human emotional connection. Studies have found that social media, and especially Instagram, have had precipitously negative effects on young women. They've found that technology has a far less effect on young men, who largely play video games or watch YouTube videos, which have negligible mental health effects in of themselves. However, for girls, Instagram's a tool for extreme non-stop competition, whether by seeing other girls look more attractive than they really are, thus making them feel bad, or seeing them not be invited to fun social events that makes them feel left out. Young female suicide and depression rates have risen horrifically since the invention of the iPhone. Technology allows us to compare our own lives with people we've never met. The slums of Camden, New Jersey are reminded of Beverly Hills every day, and Dakar, Senegal thinks about London. It also allows political radicals to connect. Incels talk to each other and become mired in their own depression. People read articles of people with similar political opinions rather than reading potentially more balanced regional-focused newspapers. Also, to be fair, people are just so awful and crass online that it spreads negativity in the world in general. People become more politically unhinged than they would be in person, which breeds radicalism and easy demonization of the other side. I think a perfect example of the information revolution and its negative effects are how many of you know more about your favorite newscaster, or maybe even me, people you've never met than your nearest neighbors. Number 3. Lack of beauty. I have lots of qualms with the last century, but the top one is lack of belief in inherent beauty. For example, I would support my home city of Philadelphia spending $500 million on building a gorgeous cathedral to commemorate the city. The thing would last 1,000 years and become a center of pride for the whole city that would honor us by all constructing it. However, it would be attacked on the left for spending money that could go towards the poor and being designed with white heteronormative architectural styles, and on the right for taking taxpayer money that could go into the economy. The shared point of view is that there's no civic pride or belief in something more beautiful than our sheer mundane existences. Most of us live in cities, which are ugly, alternating between ugly-looking houses to ugly-looking schools or work and repeat. We drive on ugly roads while doing it. The truth is that until extremely recently, most of us lived in the countryside, and most countrysides, whether the rice paddies of Japan, rolling fields of England, or the sheep pastures of New Zealand, are gorgeous and we feel connected to our environment. Similarly, until recently, houses were built to have character and represent the cultures and the people involved. The architectural style of recent years has been basically breaking down any cultural or geographic boundaries. Buildings are the same whether you're in Japan, South Africa, or New York. Most architecture is basically giant square blocks made out of steel and glass. The architecture says nothing about us and gives us no identity. It's sort of like how you would feel if you only wore black shirts and have no other option in your society. This is an overstatement, but even the best architecture of the present world is completely inhuman and unrelatable. Hagia Sophia fills me with love and pride. A New York skyscraper doesn't do the same. Look at streetwear, the dominant fashion now. Streetwear is basically a competition for how ugly you can look. It comes from designs that lower class people wore since they couldn't afford anything else. It wears purposely garish colors in order to offend. It's a fashion that exists so people show they aren't trying to be better than you. But people still spend thousands on it to show that they're better than you. We've gone from belief in inherent beauty to just having a lot of dopamine hits. The average pop song now features an attractive, scantily clad girl saying sexually explicit keywords without any context while making a lewd dance and playing a repetitive beat that means to just get your attention forever. This is since in our current capitalist model, people are paid to get people's attention in dollars without any other metric. Thus, the thing that grabs your attention rather than the thing that's good makes money. The problem with the dopamine art world is that music videos make you feel good in the moment, but afterwards, we've found from scientific studies that when your dopamine and serotonin goes up really high, it collapses downwards beneath the normal rate. After that music video, you think about how in the real world, a hot pop star doesn't want to sleep with you, which your rational brain would have known the whole time was entirely behind your abilities. The truth is that beautiful things come indirectly from meaning. If you were actually going to sleep with a pop star, you would have derived meaning from the many years it took you to become rich, charismatic, fit, and famous enough to do so. Movies like The Godfather, Lord of the Rings, and American Beauty convey artistic meanings that help explain our own emotional and narrative states to us. The Beatles convey real things besides chemical button pushing. In all fairness, beauty allows us to live far more meaningful and happy lives than the absence of beauty would. Imagine what your lifestyle would be like if you were in a gorgeous lake in rural Canada next to a giant mountains and forests, compared to living in a single cell, where you had the exact same material conditions but you never saw the sun, the air quality was worse, and there was no beauty around you whatsoever. Number 4, control and monotony. Our lives are extremely boring and predictable. I mean, in a lot of ways, that's a good thing. Life was less predictable in the Middle Ages, but that was because you weren't sure if locusts or drought were going to wipe out your crop or the Lord would draft your son for the crusade. I talked about this before in my video about zombies, but a modern person's life goes something like this. They're born in a regulated hospital and then go to a structured daycare. For kids in many areas and countries, they're not allowed to play outside without parental supervision, and then they go to school at strict times where they study pre-appointed subjects. They get into a college based off their score in a test that has little relation to the work they'll be doing, and then go to college and it just continues. College today has little to do with free thinking, and they get shoved an ideological agenda there as well. Political correctness basically results in de facto no freedom of speech or thought given to people, as their lives or chance of work can be ruined for saying the wrong things. Afterwards, they work a pre-appointed number of hours with a boss who controls how they work. Their hobbies are more regulated than ever, in that places in like the US, safety culture regulates a lot of possible hobbies. People meet their partner through a dating app algorithm and then get shoved into a retirement home when they're so old as to not slow down the rest of society. This might be a strange thing to say, but with the exception of people like slaves and servants, people were in many ways freer in the pre-industrial world, even in systems like monarchies and empires, than they are today. An 18th century peasant could wake up at whatever time they wanted. Their lives were determined by local regulations inside their village rather than external forces. They could brawl in the pub without pissing off the nanny state, educate their kids however they wanted, drink on the job, say whatever they wanted without directly conspiring to rebel, and everything in the world was done with personal relationships with people they knew, rather than with giant impersonal bureaucracies and algorithms that didn't give a damn about them. The industrial world with its complex, interdependent supply chains, the desire for power from bureaucratic governments which became more powerful due to rapid transport and large militaries, has basically worked together to turn people into interchangeable cogs with as little differentiation as possible. This created a modern world that feels deeply sterile, inhuman, and boring. People like to watch movies about the apocalypse, and I think partially lots of people wish it would happen since they're so tired of being so strongly socialized and having everything they do be preparing for the future or working for someone else's goals. The modern complex globalized system is remarkably unstable due to always trying to optimize for connectivity and short-term gain. I find the fact that COVID shut down the world economy and provoked the greatest inflationary period in human history interesting, given that COVID isn't that dangerous a disease. I don't think it even would have registered in the 19th century. Imagine what any real-sized player war could do. Number 5. Lack of ideology. One of the things I realized the older I got was really how little clue we have about how we're supposed to act and what we're supposed to be doing. I grew up viewing the world a certain way and assumed there were only a handful of others. However, the more I studied history and traveled, the more I realized how there isn't a right-left binary, a religious-non-religious binary, and the world in general was significantly more complicated than I ever could have imagined. I had always wondered why modern Christianity mucked around in stuff like masturbation, the Trinity, or abortion, which the Bible never covers, and then it occurred to me. In a scary world, we look for answers among the chaos, and since the West is a civilization founded upon Christianity, people turn to reference Christianity on nearly every topic, whether or not the Bible actually cared or did talk about those topics. One of the more horrifying things of the modern world is that this is the first time since the Axial Age, or before the birth of Christ, in which there's no clear value system that the world should follow. Much as it might not seem it, the 20th century was the era of the most intense religious struggle in the history of the world, except those religions all placed man as the dominant force in the universe, whether in the form of communism, fascism, or liberalism. Liberalism won the battle, but even today, it faces fatal attacks whether in the form of authoritarianism in the second or third world, or social justice and right-wing populism in the first. This is caused by a series of problems in liberal philosophy or the idea that the individual should always be prioritized in society that I don't have time to talk about, so here's a text wall. Durkheimer, the founding scholar of religious philosophy, believed that religions should have four characteristics, or metaphysics, like what's our place in the world, ethics, or how do I become a good person, ceremonies, and community. None of our modern ideologies fulfill any of these purposes except metaphysics, and only that barely. Ideologies are like 2-bit versions of religion in complexity. They take single notions and then apply them across all of reality. Take social justice, which takes white men bad to insane extremes of not being able to denounce far worse atrocities in non-white countries, saying cultural mixing is evil and actively discriminating against other ethnic minorities like Asians and Jews. On the other side, take Reaganite capitalism, which basically only looks at economics and even so only at GDP growth, ignoring everything else like environment, quality quality of life, inequality, geopolitics, cultural cohesion, debt, and local politics for short-term GDP growth, which largely accrues to the elite. I remember reading Jordan Peterson's 12 Rules for Life and thinking, this is generally accurate, but it's stuff my dad taught me by age 15. And then I talked to my friends about his conclusions and I realized not everyone has been taught stuff like take pride in your work or tell the truth even when it hurts his children. It's sort of horrifying how lost many young people are today. I meet loads of people who think life has no meaning, nothing they do is worthwhile, the world is fundamentally broken, that they're born into guilt, and that they'll die lonely and poor. This isn't what the next generation should be thinking, it should be the thought process of the insides of a mental ward. This is since ideas allow us to transcend the suffering of reality. When the world sucks, the idea of something better drives us forward. However, when people have no direction of what's worthwhile and have no broad ideas on how to act, the world just drags them down. It's crazy how much we take traditional religions for granted. I always find it amusing when I meet atheists and their supposedly rational philosophic views are still deeply grounded in supposedly irrational Christian doctrines. Once you remove the meaning given to us by traditional religions, we're just staring into the black void, and with all that blackness and nothing, we realize how little we are. Number 6, poor physical health. Obesity has risen precipitously in the modern world. There are now 2 billion obese people around the planet. Obesity is driven heavily by sugar, which is realistically a drug that the whole world and societies are addicted to. Society's addicted to a lot of drugs. Caffeine's an obvious one. Marijuana realistically acts as an opiate for people who can't otherwise handle their lives, and porn is pretty similar. It's interesting to see that, at least in the US, health has actively declined. White males live shorter lives, Americans as a whole are fatter, shorter, have less sex, and die of drugs more than before. The declines in sex are important here. Americans and probably other regions around the world are having significantly less sex than in previous decades, probably driven by mobile phones, smaller social networks, and stuff like that. Humans are inherently biological creatures, and our main prime motivators are status and sex, and so when those get weakened, bad things happen. You can actually predict crises happening across history when the marriage rate goes above age 28, since it means society's under an incredible amount of stress. It reminds me of how carriage horses have blinders attached to them so they don't freak out all the street traffic around them. People use drugs to deal with hyper-structured, crowded lives that we didn't evolve for. Remember, almost all of history has been spent in rural tribes, and so imagine how your nerves react to the chaos and confusion of modern cities and the high stimuli modern world. We're sort of trained in the modern West to not see the body and mind being connected due to ancient Greek philosophy, but they totally are. On a personal basis, I've really gotten into fitness in the last couple months, and I've been doing keto, intermittent fasting, and lifting, and it's improved my mood, concentration, and willpower tremendously. Number 7, lack of community. There's this fascinating book called Bowling Alone about how your average American social group has shrunk markedly since the 1960s. Bowling, political, church, Boy Scouts, and other groups have seen collapsing attendance. This has come from a combination of factors like rising commute times, people watching more TV, etc. People's need for community is obvious considering we're herd animals, but looking at statistics on loneliness, lack of romantic relationships, and the like, it shows that we're really not doing a good job with this. The incels are really fascinating here. This is a political movement explicitly designed around not getting laid, which comes partially from lack of social communities for these guys to meet girls, but also from not having communities on how to socialize them to prepare them for courtship. School shooters are a similar category of people who feel lonely and impotent against the world. They aren't socialized in how to deal with society, and society is less powerful, so they fall through the cracks and become vengeful and murderous. People like to think that communications via screens would equal interpersonal communication. However, we've all been through COVID and know this isn't true, and that this is a major mistake in the social structuring of the last couple decades. So we've gone through all the reasons I think lead to unhappiness in the modern world. Now before we end, let's briefly roll through some of the historic factors that I think lead to where we are. Explanation 1, early industrialization. The easiest and best explanation is that we're in the early stages of the industrial world. The Industrial Revolution happened 200 years ago, and in almost all the world it's been significantly more recent than that. This means that we have very little idea on how to happily manage industrialized societies. For a comparison, it took thousands upon thousands of years for societies to be able to fully adapt to the previous agricultural revolution. If we look at all the political and philosophic debates going on now, they're primarily driven by trying to figure out the boundaries given to us by industrialization. The transgender debate, for example, is about if technology has transcended gender, and the immigration one turns out to be, has the modern world transcended the ethnic group? Most of this is driven by the Industrial Revolution, with lots clustering around complications living around schedules in cities and with women in the workforce. We built our societies for utility first and everything else second, which resulted in the lack of beauty and lack of community. Women as housewives are the main pillars of community, and their entrance to the workforce, for all its benefits, did weaken it. Similarly, lots of poor health has driven people eating out more without housewives cooking.
This isn't just the industrialized world either. In places like Africa, which never saw the Industrial Revolution, there's this thing called anomie, in which the tribal social constructs and boundaries of thousands of years have been ripped apart by the introduction of capitalism in large cities, which results in high crime, disaffection, and not knowing how society works.
The information revolution has similarly thrown us a lot of curveballs that we don't know how to deal with that I talked about earlier in the video. As well as this, none of the traditional religions were able to leave the Industrial Revolution unscathed, which creates the problems with ideological void. As an easy answer, we're still mucking around how to form an industrial society, and we're unclear about what the right answers are. We should try to remain non-judgmental and humble until we find something that even approximates them. The second reason is the blank slate view of humanity. This belief runs counter to all the science now, which says that humans are a combination of genetics and social pressures that mix while being inside biologically defined limits. However, a lot of the problems we have now are driven by belief that humans can basically be molded by whatever society tells them. The idea that humans could adapt to whatever ugly surroundings they were put in, could live without ideology, less friends, and with boring and monotonous lives, could only come out of a blank slate view. This is a rude thing to say, but I wonder how many of the people who built the modern world were autistic or somewhere on that spectrum and didn't even think of these factors at all. Remember, the last century was heavily built by male experts and scientists, who, more so than the average population, are on that spectrum. Similarly, a lot of the philosophers we use to make decisions inside our unconscious, underlying mental systems, such as Jeremy Bentham and the utilitarians, or Kant, were respectively extremely or somewhere on the autism spectrum. The blank slate view is paired with a dislike of anything biological that came out of syphilis and the Black Death, which had the effect of making people dislike anything that made humans appear animal. In the Middle Ages, people had sex in front of their friends, young women would walk through the streets naked to the baths, friends would show their shit to each other during dinner, people would cut up giant animal carcasses at the dinner table, knights would write poetry about taking pleasure in murdering their opponents, torture was a public event that families would go to, and farting and spitting were acceptable at the dinner table. I would say that the blank slate view came out of the desire to turn people into interchangeable cogs and remove the human-animal element as much as possible. And the third reason is the bureaucratic state. Due to military technologies that resulted in giving more power to centralized government over local powers like feudal lords, alongside stuff like the railroads that made transportation easier, centralized governments have been having a field day over the last 500 years. The world became run by massive, impersonal bureaucratic empires. This trend has continued across modern history, reaching its peak a little bit after the Second World War. Over time, the state has purposely leveled human relations to make them easier to number and control. An easy example is street life. Go to a third world country like Mexico and you'll see far more activity in the streets from people like vendors, street performers, and the like than in the US, in which those kind of people are regulated out of existence since they're harder to control and tax than people with fixed locations. You can hear horror stories of stuff like how the LA government shut down a guy who was building movable homes for the homeless due to it not being under their control, or cops shutting down a child's lemonade stand, or being called in on children playing outside. Europe, meanwhile, has regulated itself into economic stagnation, declining from 38 to 24% of the world's economy since 1965, while the US has remained a stable quarter. Stuff like this has ripple effects. When zoning boards control where you can build houses to a tremendous degree, the cost of housing goes up and people have less kids. When people feel like they could have legal action against them for showing initiative, they don't. People retreat into their homes and the community and liveliness of the society declines. Meanwhile, society gets weaker, the bureaucratic state gets more powerful. Maybe that was the plan the whole time. Reason 4, bourgeois capitalism. The final driving force behind the current unhappiness is the structure of bourgeois capitalist society. Bourgeois refers to the merchant classes and the values that went with them. This varies region by region, but generally bourgeois values are most powerful in places like the US or northern European countries like Germany. The bourgeoisie prioritized emphasis on measured time, controlling sexual urges, objectivity, working hard, and saving the present for the future. These are the values that made the West wealthy and powerful and are extremely effective at creating wealth, but they aren't the values that cover the whole human condition. The bourgeoisie evolved in a complex ecosystem with the central government, church, and nobility. Now only the central government and them are left.
It feels like in a lot of modern, especially North American and East Asian society, the emphasis for life is only put on work and money, without a position for religious transcendence, search for beauty, or loving communities. Only a small group of people, largely men, will get happiness out of work, leaving everyone else behind. The bourgeois system created a reaction called the counterculture in the mid-20th century, which involves succumbing to sexual urges, partying, not paying attention to time, not trusting society, and not working. This hasn't done any good, since the counterculture by structure has been decadent and idiotic. I didn't call the hippie movement an idiotic, sexual, Africanized, early Christian monastic movement for nothing in a previous video. Bourgeois capitalism, as well as industrialized society and centralized governments, are incentivized to turn people into cogs in their machine, removing the individual, personal, and human elements. I'm not sure this has to be the case, however. A primarily gig economy, which I think is where we're headed, for example, would be personal and allow people to manage their schedules as they liked, and would be just as capitalist. Well, that video was depressing. I'd like to have a section here giving answers of how to get out of this, but I'm not that smart yet. It's always easier to criticize and harder to build constructively. Give me a couple years for a video how to make people happy in the modern world. Well, I hope that video was helpful. If you like this video, please like, comment, subscribe, or stay tuned for additional content. Or alternatively, check out my Twitter, Instagram, or Patreon, where I've got several hundred pages written for both my cultural history of America and history of the world. As always, thanks for watching and have a great day.